Children, welcome back to the next session of civics class. In previous session, we discussed about the five writs, restrictions on fundamental rights, and 11 fundamental duties. We will continue with the same chapter, the next subtopic, that is directive principles of state policy. This directive principles of state policy, it contains in part 4 of Indian Constitution. It deals with Article 38 to 51, and its aim are, first aim is that it is a guideline given by the Indian Constitution, and it is to create social and economic condition under which citizen can lead a good life. Now, what do you mean by this social and economic condition? How we are going to provide social and economic condition to Indians? Social condition means where we will provide them liberty, where we will give them equality of status, opportunity, fraternity, and also we will give them economic condition, means equal opportunities should be given, no any type of economic exploitation should take place, and there will be a proper check and balance of income, proper distribution of wealth should take place. So this such type of social and economic environment should be there under which our people can lead a good life. The second aim is to establish a welfare state, and this is only our national goal. This is only our ultimate motive, to establish a welfare state. Welfare state means when we do good for the people, when we are taking any steps for the progress and development of the people. Because if the people are progress, if the people are developed one, automatically our country will also become a developed one. And the third aim is to transform political democracy to social and economic democracy. This was the thinking of Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar, who was the father of Indian Constitution. Now, his aim was to transfer this political democracy to social and economic democracy. Let me explain you this term, political, social and economic democracy. Political democracy means where the people have the right to participate in politics directly or indirectly, they can choose the representatives. So it does not mean that welfare state can be established only through political democracy. If we want to really make a welfare state, then we have to transform this political democracy to social and economic democracy. Now, what does social and democracy means? Social democracy means where the people will get the liberty, the freedom, equality will be enjoyed by the people. That is social democracy. And economic democracy means there will be proper check and balance. No such economic exploitation should take place, and everybody should get the chance in every walks of life. There should be equal pay for equal work for both men and women. So this is economic democracy. Proper distribution of wealth among the people, this is also economic democracy. So welfare state cannot be established only through political democracy. It have to also achieve social and political democracy. So, Overall, directive principles aim is to establish a welfare state, and this is only its national goal. Next topic we come across is classification of directive principles. Now, directive principles are in large number. There are the total number of directive principles are 21. But here mainly we have categorized under four. First category is economic principles. Economic principles means equal pay for equal work for both men and women. Now, what does it mean, equal pay for equal work for both men and women? It means that no economic inequality should take place in the society on the basis of either on the basis of caste or on the basis of sex. Means if same work is done both by men and women, it should be paid equally. The second is adequate means of livelihood for all. Means that every person should be given the opportunity to earn, to run their livelihood, to continue their livelihood. So, adequate means of livelihood should be given to all. The next principle which we come across is social principles. In this also we have two subcategories here. First is to raise standard of living and public health. And the second is to safeguard children against exploitation and moral degradation. Means, raise standard of living and public health. Public health should be given more priority. No people should work under hazardous conditions. And the people's living standard should be raised. Means proper facilities should be given to the people under which they can, you can say that they can do their work. Next is to safeguard children against exploitation. No any type of economic exploitation should take place. And prevention of child abuse should be there. Means we cannot exploit children in any way. And moral degradation means we have to protect the children against exploitation also, and even for moral degradation. Moral degradation means when their moral and ethical standard of behavior goes down, when their moral things that what is good or what is bad, there is lacking of the sense of thinking that what is good and bad. So we should see that the children should not be exploited, and moral degradation of children should not take place. Means we have to keep in mind moral degradation of children should not go down at any cost. Because once it go down, it will be very difficult. In school also, children are studying, but before they go through the studies, it is very essential that they should have moral things present in them. Means what is good and bad, what things they should do, what things they should not do. That is very important, and moral thing is very essential part of human being. The next principle is Gandhian principle. According to Gandhiji, who gave much priority to village panchayats, village panchayats, which was also one of the guideline of directive principles, and later on it became an Panchayat Act was passed, because all those directive principles, whichever guidelines have been provided in Indian Constitution, many of those guidelines have become a law or an right. We will give you those examples in my next lecture. So, organizing village panchayats. And the second is promote cottage industry. Gandhiji was a very strong believer of promoting cottage industries. When Britishers were exploiting us, that time also our Indians were, that time only cottage industry was very prevalent, and Gandhiji was one of the social reformer who supported this, and he supported a lot to go, and it should be progressed at every scheme. Cottage industry means those industries. Cottage means what? House, home. Those industries which takes place at home, and no hired labor are there. All the family members will be involved in this. That is only cottage industry. And Gandhiji supported it so much that today, nowadays, you will see that cottage industry is progressing much. You will see many women are involved in making papads, badis and all that. That are all cottage industries. They are also involved in some small weaving, crafting. That is also a cottage industry. So, at that time, Gandhi used to say that cottage industry is the main source of income. Next classification under the fourth, this is the fourth one. This is the fourth category under which directive principles of state policy has been classified. That is principles related to international peace and security. First, to maintain just and honorable relations between nations. As we all know that our country is a great follower and believer of international peace and security, because India itself has suffered at the hands of British. Say no. So, we all know what will be the outcome if there is no peace and security. So, our main motive is to maintain just and honorable relations between nations. Mean we have will be having a friendly relations with different nations. Second is international peace and security. As I told you that our country is a strong believer of peace, so it also promotes international peace and security, not only within the country, it is also promoting international peace around the world. Then it also believes in settlement of disputes, either legally or by arbitration. What do you mean by arbitration? Means sometimes we solve the disputes by moving to the court, which is called litigation. And sometimes we solve the disputes outside the court, that is arbitration. So we also believe in settlements of disputes peacefully. Now is significance of directive principles of state policy. Fundamental rights is a legal obligation, but directive principles is a moral obligation. Moral obligation means it considers, there is a sense of consideration that what is right and what is wrong. We have to judge which is not, what is good for us, what is not good for us. So it is a moral obligation which has to be performed by the government at all levels for the welfare of people. And many such examples are there. Means these are the directive principles which are the moral obligations and which has to be performed by the government at every level. Every level means there are different levels of government: local level, zilla level, state level, and at the last is central level. And what will be its motive? Welfare of the people. Always give priority to people's interest. That should be the main motive of the government. So many such examples are there. Many such guidelines steps have been taken by the government, which has today become an act or has become a fundamental right. So let's come across such examples. First is right to education. In my previous session, when I was discussing about fundamental right, that is right to freedom, where this right to education comes, it is included in fundamental right in 2002. Before that, it was there in directive principles. Now the question is that if it was earlier in directive principle, then what was the need to add in fundamental rights? Yes, this is the very important question which can be raised by you. The difference is that fundamental rights are justiciable, whereas directive principles are non-justiciable. So if the people or if the children were not getting this education earlier, they were not in the position to move to the court to claim for it. But now, if they doesn't get this right, they can straightway move to the court to seek and claim for that right. So this has become a right today. The second step which our government took was Environment Protection Act. This Environment Protection Act was introduced in 1986 under Article 253. Environment Protection Act means where whatever species are there present in environment, where plants, birds, wildlife, all has to be protected. Wildlife Protection Act was also passed in 1972 and further it was amended in 2002. So these acts has been passed by the government. Earlier it was included in directive principle, but today it has become a law because the government thinks that these acts are very essential for the welfare of people. As I told you, people interest is given more importance. So these acts are very important because it protects the environment, it safeguards environment from ecological imbalance, and it also protects the different species found in the environment. It protects the different species found in the environment like birds, plants, animals, etc. Next is National Commission for the Welfare of Women has been also established. This commission has been established for the women's society so that no any type of harassment should take place. There should be no inequality takes place on the basis of sex. So, for this National Commission has been set up for the welfare of women. and the last is right to work, that is for rural people under MNREGA. This MNREGA was introduced in 2005. It is an Indian labor law and social security measure which aims to provide right to work. And whom to be provided this right to work? Specially for the rural people, rural unemployed people, to provide them livelihood security. That means the government will provide this right to work to those rural unemployed people who should be also given social security, economic security, those who should be given livelihood so that they can lead a better life. So this is also working in a better way still today. The full form of MNREGA is Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Act. What is it? Mahatma Gandhi Rural, R stands for rural, E stands for employment, G stands for guarantee, and A stands for act. And it was passed in 2005. And at present, if you see, number of rural people have got this employment opportunities, have got the source of livelihood. They are now, most of the people are now employed one. So these are the today's topic we came across. So overall, we came across this directive principles. What is directive principle? It is a moral obligation. It is a moral obligation and it is contained in part 4 of the Indian Constitution. Its main aim is to establish a welfare state, and apart from political democracy, social and economic democracy should also be established, which was the main aim of Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. It has been classified into 4 categories: economic principles, social principles, Gandhian principles, and principles related to international peace and security. Now children, today's assignment is that you have to, this is your assignment, that you have to classify the directive principles of state policy under 4 categories. Now what are those 4 categories? These are only the 4 categories. Let me explain you again. These are the 4 categories. First is economic principle, where you will write these 2 points. These are the 2 features coming under economic principle. Then is your social principle. Here, raise standard of living and public health and safeguard children against exploitation and moral degradation. This is your social principle. Next coming your Gandhian principle, where you will write what features or what is the aim under this guiding Gandhian principle, that is organizing village panchayats and also promoting cottage industry. And the last classification is your principles related to international peace and security, where peace is given more priority, where settlements of disputes should take place, where just and honorable relations should be established between nations. So this is your homework, which you will do in your civics copy. Classify the directive principles of state policy under 4 categories. And if you have any queries, then you can post your question in WhatsApp group and I will sort your doubts. I will clear your doubts there. So do this homework in your civics copy. Thank you.